Well, if you got your Bibles, I'd like for you to take them and turn with me this morning to the book of Exodus. And we're going to look at Exodus chapter 20 this morning. And we're going to be in Exodus 20 for a few weeks beyond this point, because we're going to take a look at the Ten Commandments. Somebody say the Ten Commandments. How many of you know they're still in the Bible? Amen. Can we get the lights all the way up, please? We're going to take a look at Exodus chapter 20. How many remember, I was listening to Pastor Nathan just a moment ago talking about how that in his family they had this tradition. And this tradition was you know, coming on Sunday nights and you know, having root beer floats. And it sounded like a great tradition to me. We didn't have many traditions in my family. My family was really messed up. But there was a tradition, if I can think of anything, I could think of one of the things that I remember looking back over the course of my growing up. One of the things we did, or at least I remember doing on more than one occasion, is during Easter, I remember watching Cecil B. DeMille's Ten Commandments. How many remember Cecil B. DeMille's Ten Commandments? And I remember it because... As a kid, it kind of freaked me out a little bit, right? I mean, part of it was really cool. Part of it was really scary. And the part that was cool was when they went through the Red Sea. I just think that scene, and you know, they had the new, like the remake, which is the Exodus version. And I didn't like that so much because, number one, they explained away the miracle of the parting of the Red Sea, right? And it just really, it just wasn't the same. But I remember as a kid sitting there, and this was back in the day when, I don't know, maybe the television was even black and white. And I remember sitting there Indian style in front of my television watching that, and all of a sudden, you know, the Red Sea, as Charlton Heston got up there and his hair is blowing in the wind, and he said, "Stand back and see the salvation of God." And he lifts up the rod of the Lord and... right? I mean, the wind starts blowing and... and they go across on dry ground. And as a little kid, I'm just going, whoa. Right? And then the next part is when he's up on the mountain. And he goes up to the mountain, right? And he's climbing on Mount Moriah, and so he makes his way up to the mountain, and he's been up there for like 40 days, and so he's up on the mountain. And he's up on the mountain, and all of a sudden God shows up. As God shows up, you hear the voice of God saying, "I am the Lord your God." As a little kid, man, I mean, I'm just sitting there going, whoa. You know, and all of a sudden, this ball of fire appears. Have you never seen it? Somebody just looking at me like, God. This ball of fire appears. And the finger of God comes out of that ball. Well, this fire, this flame, this, and it... right next to his head, I mean, and there are sparks and flat, and he's, yeah, and God is riding on the side of the mountain, and he carves out these Ten Commandments. "I am the Lord thy God. Thou shalt have no other gods before me." "Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain." And I'm just sitting there going, whoa, God, serious? Right? And that scene, man, it makes you feel, number one, God is serious about this. But secondly, it kind of made me walk away thinking that God might even been a little mad at me. that God was perhaps this angry God that was up there just forcing me or making me do what he wanted me to do. And if I didn't, he was going to smack me. Any of you ever get that impression of God? You know, but when I read the scripture, here's what I read. See, when I come to Jesus and when I came to know him personally, here's what I found out. I found out that the Jesus that I know is really not the Jesus or the God that I had imagined as a kid. Because the God that I came to know wasn't a God who was here to hurt me and harm me, but he was a God that was here to help me and bless me. And so this morning, as we look at this, we need to understand that God's not here to punish us. As we look at these Ten Commandments, God's here to protect us. God's not here to harm us, but he's here to help us. And as we look over the next few Sundays at these Ten Commandments, let's understand that these are 10 keys that God wants to bless you with. See, I understand that every command God gives us is for our benefit and for our blessing. Are you with me? See, we parents, we understand this. As a child, I didn't understand this. But as a parent, I understand. As a grandparent, we've got 9 grandchildren. Somebody say, wow. Somebody say, Pastor Dobie, you don't look that old. Thank you. I just needed to be encouraged this morning. And we have 9 grandchildren, and we love all of our grandchildren. There's this one grandchild that, Well, there's this one grandchild that we watch, my wife watches. Okay, she watches her 5 days a week now. And she's watched, I think, almost every one of our grandchildren. We've watched them and kind of take. Yeah, I can see. I don't see it, but I know her face is on the screen. This one is named Stella. Some say Stella. Stella. Now, Stella's at the age where she has just recently, within the last, couple of months maybe, started crawling. And, you know, first she started scooting herself along, and then, you know, she got up on one knee, and she, you know, did that, and then now it's two, and now, she just boogies, right? I mean, she has this little motor that if you don't watch her, the next thing you know, boom, she's over here, and then she's gone, and then you're wondering where in the world she is, and we have this tri-level home, and so, you know, our main living room is our family room is on the first level. Then you go up these stairs, and it's only 3 stairs, but then you come into our kitchen area, and right next to our kitchen area, there's another living room, and then we have about 10 stairs that lead up to the bedrooms, and Stella can get up these 3 stairs like boom. And at the top of those 3 stairs, that's the kitchen area, and there's this little railing, and what she likes to do is she likes to crawl up those 3 stairs and stand at the railing. You know, and just kind of look at you. And the first couple of times that she's done it, the first couple of times, we kind of freaked out. We'd see her standing there. We'd go, no! And she'd go. Yeah, and we would scare her more than we were scared, right? And then we'd run and we'd grab her like, you almost fell down that 10,000-foot cliff. Because we didn't want her to get hurt. Now, we weren't saying no, because we wanted to make her life a bummer. We were saying no because we wanted to make her life better. We don't want a little cast on that 1-year-old arm. Are you with me? And so we were wanting to bless her, not burden her. We were wanting to help her, not harm her. And so when God comes to you, sometimes as children, we look up and we say, God, you're just trying to bum my life out. But if from a parent's perspective, we would look at the command of the Lord, it's not to burden us,
It's to bless us. It's not to make our life a bummer, but it's to make our life better. So today we're going to start on that first command. Somebody say the first command. And how many of you know these are commands, not suggestions? Do I have the right group? Okay, I thought I was sitting in front of a bunch of heathens this morning. How many of you know these are commands, not suggestions? These are not the 10 suggestions. God's not coming to you saying, yeah, it'd be kind of be nice if you maybe thought about, if you get the time, check this out. No, God's coming. God is saying, these are the rules for righteousness. These are the commands. And understand, I'm not doing this to bum you out. I'm doing this to bless you. So these are the keys to the blessing of God in your life. This is the way to wisdom. These are the keys to right relationships. If you want your family to be on a foundation that's solid, obey this word. If you want to be messed up, then go ahead and disregard. And for the most part, society is disregard, and that's why society's messed up. But can I say that for centuries, these Ten Commandments have been the bedrock of civilization? I mean, these Ten Commandments are the very foundation for our system of jurisprudence today. And America would not be what America is today, and we would have not come as far as we've come had it not been for this word. And so this morning we're going to take a look, and we're going to start at that first command. Some say the first command. And I think there's a reason God starts with this first command, and I think that they're not haphazard. But I think God starts with this first command because he understands that all these other commands are contingent and hinge upon this command. And so this morning we're going to take a look at it. But before we do, let me just give you one scripture. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 6 and 7 says this. It says, do not forget the commands that I'm giving you. Teach them to your children. So we say, never forget and teach them to your children. Turn to your neighbor, tell them, don't forget. Come, tell them like you mean it. Don't forget. And then look at them and tell them, teach them to your children. So he says two things. Remember them and teach them. 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 Remember them. How many of your children know the Ten Commandments? Forget about our children. How many of you know the Ten Commandments? If I were to go out there today and I were to ask you, give me all the Ten Commandments in order, would you be able to do that? Okay. By your reaction, I know you can't. Okay. Or the person next to you can't. You can, but the person next to you can't. So this morning, hopefully by the end of this series, we'll be able to take a look at the Ten Commandments, and we will know the Ten Commandments. So Exodus chapter 20, if you're there, say I'm there. If you're ready, say let's go. Exodus chapter 20, let's take a look at it. We're just going to look at one verse, that being verse 2, and God says this, you shall have no other gods before me. Somebody say it with me, you shall have no other gods before me. Say it again, you shall have no other gods before me. You shall have no other God. What's the principle? The principle is this: put God first. Somebody say, put God first. If you want to boil down the first commandment to a couple of words, here it is: put God first. And so today we're going to be talking about putting God first. Now notice he says this. He says, you shall have no other gods before me. Now I look at this and I think to myself, God, if you're the only God and there is only one God, and Moses said, hear, O Israel, the Lord thy God is one. And God, if you're the only God, then what do you mean you shall have no other gods before me? If you're the only God, how can I have other gods if there aren't any other gods? Well, see, we don't understand the definition of gods, and it's written in the little g here. And so he's not talking about the big God. He's talking about little gods. And the definition of a God is this. Let me give you the definition of a God. The definition of God is this. It is anything, so say anything, and everything that dominates your life and that controls you. Let me say it again. It's anything and everything that dominates your life and or controls you. That is the definition of a God. Anything and everything that dominates your life or controls you. Is there anything that controls you? Is there anything that dominates your life? Is there anything that dominates your time? Is there anything that distracts you and anything that you have to give yourself to? And in that case, then yeah, maybe there are some little gods in my life. Because by that definition, anything can be a god. How many of you know your car can be a god? If your car dominates you and controls you, and you just have to go out there and polish that dude and love that, and you have named her, and there's not too many of you guys like, your motorcycle can be your god. Come on, somebody. Let me get a little closer. Your job can be your god. If your job dominates you, if your job controls you, you see, there are some people that it's not your job. It's some people, it's not your car. It's not your motorcycle. It's not your boat. But there are some people that maybe baseball or golf is your god. Because you can't come to church on Sunday and put God first, because you got to go out and you got to play that. You got to get that round in. Are you with me? So there, anything can be a god. People can be gods. People that we place in front of God, that we would rather obey them and please them rather than obeying and pleasing God, it becomes a god. Are you with me this morning? And so this morning, how do I put, Pastor, listen, I understand all that, but let's just set that to the side. I want to obey God. I want to please Him. I understand that if I'm going to have a good foundation in my life, it's got to be the Word of God. And I want my family to be blessed, and I want God to bless everything I set my hand to do. So I want to be obedient. So how do I put God first? I'm glad you asked. And so this morning, I'm going to give you four ways to put God first. Some say four ways. Put God first. Number one, put Him first in your day. Some say put Him first in your day. Secondly, put Him first in your week. Some say put Him first in your week. Thirdly, put Him first in your finances. Some say put Him first in your finances. And the number four, put Him first in your relationships. Some say in my day. Come on, say it like you mean it. In my day, in my week, in my finances, in my relationships. Turn to your neighbor, tell them in your day, in your week, in your finances, and in your relationships. So these are four simple ways that I'm just going to try to give you what I think is a practical way in which you can put God first. Number one, put God first in your day. You say, Pastor, did you just come up with that? No, that's in the Bible. In fact, I look and it's all over in the Bible, but let me just give you one example of one guy in the Bible named David who put God first in his day. You remember David? Do you remember killing the giant David? Do you remember getting anointed when he was a nobody David? Do you remember getting called into the chambers of the king to play the harp for the king because the king was tormented and only your music would bring him peace, David? Do you remember the David who rode into the city and they sang a song and they said, David has slain his tens of thousands and Saul is slain his thousands. Do you remember the David who they wrote the song about, David? Do you remember the guy who established the kingdom and became king when he was nobody, David? Do you remember the David who had a son by the name of Solomon who was even more blessed than him? I'm talking about David. I'm talking about the anointed David. I'm talking about the giant killer David. I'm talking about the David who God said, you are a man after my own heart. I'm talking about that David. Now, how do you get to be that kind of a person? How do you get to be the person who God looks down and says, you know what, of all the people in Israel, that guy pleases me. That guy I'm going to anoint even though he's nobody. That guy I'm going to give a giant to. That guy I'm going to turn the kingdom from this guy to that one because that one pleases me. God, how do I get up under that blessing? How do I walk like that man walked. What is the secret of the success of David? Well, we can read it in the Bible. It's no secret. Because David said this. He said in Psalm 5, verses 1 through 3, "Give ear to my words, O Lord." This is the word of David. This is the guy who killed a giant. This is the king. And if David were here, you'd listen to him. Because David's awesome. And David's bad to the bone. And David just took out the giant. And maybe years later, you'd listen to him because he's the king. And you'd sit here with pen in hand, writing on a pad, saying, "Okay, David, give us the keys to your success because we want to be like you, David." David makes Warren Buffett look like a pauper. He does. You take a look at David's net worth, and he eclipses everybody today. And you would sit there and you would say, "David, I get to spend a moment with you. David, give me the words of wisdom. Pour into me, man. I just want to grow. I want to be like you." And here David comes and David says, "Here's my key." This is the secret to it all. He said, "Give ear to my words, O Lord. Consider my meditation. Hearken unto the voice of my cry. My King and my God, for unto thee will I pray. My voice shalt thou hear in the morning. O Lord, in the morning will I direct my prayer unto thee and will look." He would say in another place in Psalm 55, "I will pray morning, noon, and night, pleading aloud with God, and he will hear and he will answer." You want to know David's key to success? He put God first in the daytime. Every day he put God first. Every day he set some time alone with God. It reminds me of a guy by the name of Cornelius in Acts chapter 10, who was of, the Bible says, the Italian regiment. So obviously he was a Roman soldier, and he was of the Italian band, and yet he was a God-fearing man. And in fact, here's what the scripture says. The scripture says in Acts chapter 10, if we can get that up there, it says this. It says, "There was a man named Cornelius." Some say Cornelius. "He and all his family were devout and God-fearing." Look at this. "And he gave generously to those in need and prayed to God regularly." Someone say, "Pray to God regularly." Come on, say it like you mean it. Pray to God regularly. Look at me. Do you pray to God regularly? Good. I'm glad I hear some people saying yes. I hear a lot of people that are staying quiet. But that's okay. My question is, do you pray to God? Or is God an emergency lever that you pull every time you get in trouble? You go and you break the glass and you pull the lever because you want God to come through in an emergency. And God's more of an emergency, prayer is more of an emergency kind of thing than it is a regular kind of thing. Jamie and I were reading just recently, in fact, a couple of days ago, we were reading Mark Batterson's book. The partner to Circle Maker, which if you haven't read Circle Maker, you need to read Circle Maker. If you want a good book to read and you want to grow in this area of your life, Circle Maker is a great book to read, but this is like a devotional that goes with it. And it's called Drawing Circles, isn't it? Drawing Circles. And so in this book, here's what he says. I love this. Let's get that scripture back up. It says this. It says, he says, of those four words, which are so powerful, pray to God regularly. See, this guy by the name of Cornelius, if you read the story, Cornelius prayed to God regularly. Just leave that up there. He prayed to God regularly, and because he prayed to God regularly, irregular things regularly happened. I need to say that again because some of you are just kind of looking at me like, what'd you just say? The phrase that I got from Batterson that I'll have for the rest of my life is, because Cornelius prayed regularly, irregular things regularly happened. What do you mean? In this story, he's praying regularly. He's going to God regularly. As he prays every day, he's going to God. And then one day, Peter shows up and knocks on his door. And Peter has had a vision that a sheet has been let down from heaven, and in this sheet there are all kinds of animals which Jews don't eat. And God says, rise up and eat. And Peter says, I'm not going to eat that stuff. And God says, eat. And Peter says, I'm not going to eat that stuff. And three times God says, eat. Rise up and eat. And Peter says, I'm not. And God says, do not call unclean what I have called clean. And because of this vision, Peter understands that now the gospel is going from the Jews to the Gentiles. And so he comes and he knocks on the door of this man who prayed regularly. And this irregular situation comes to this man who prayed regularly. Because when you pray regularly, irregular situations happen to you regularly. Oh, you're not getting this, man. I mean, here was David who prayed to God regularly, morning, noon, and night. I will pray unto you. And as he prayed to God regularly, irregular things regularly happened to him, because as he prayed to God regularly, these irregular things, I mean, one day he slays a giant. The next day he gets anointed king, and then they're singing songs, and then he has a kingdom, and he's sitting on a throne, and regularly irregular things happen because he regularly prays. God, let me pray regularly because I want irregular blessings from heaven regularly. Are you getting what I'm laying down? Are you picking this up? You see, if you want irregular miracles in your life, then you pray regularly, and regularly amazing miracles will happen. Whew. I want to walk up under that kind of blessing. Amen. So number one, put him first in your day. Somebody say, put them first in your day. Secondly, put them first in your week. Somebody say, put them first in your week. Where do we see that? Put them first in your week. The book of Acts tells us, upon the first day of the week, when they were gathered together to break bread, Paul discoursed with them. Paul preached to them. Paul talked with them. And he prolonged his speech. And he preached until midnight. Yay, Paul. I will not try to duplicate that. But upon the first day of the week, they gathered together to break bread. Somebody say, gathered together to break bread. 1 Corinthians tells us, upon the first day of the week, let each of you lay by him in store, that no collections be made when I come. What's he talking about? He's talking about when you come together. You look at the New Testament, they had church on the first day of the week. Now, why did they have church on the first day of the week? How many of you know Sunday's not the Sabbath? Love the way you're shouting. We talk about keeping the Sabbath holy. I'll talk about that in a couple of weeks. But Sunday is not the Sabbath. The Sabbath day is the day of rest. The Sabbath day was the... On 6 days God worked, and on the seventh day he rested. You know what your Sabbath day is? Your Sabbath day is Saturday. That's the Sabbath day. Sunday's not the Sabbath day. Sunday is not the end of the week. Sunday is the beginning of the week. Are you with me? Somebody said, well, I just got to take off Sunday because Sunday's my day of rest. No. Sunday is the first day of the week. And if you want to put God first, you get up on the first day of the week and you come to the house of God, because that's when the early church worshiped God. They worshiped him on the first day of the week. Good preaching, Pastor. Preach on. Thank you. I think I will. But as we look at this, here's what the scripture says. The scripture says, not forsaking the assembling of yourselves together as the custom of some is, but exhorting one another, so much more as you see the day approaching. What is he talking about? Here the writer of Hebrews is saying, look, in the last days, there's going to be a falling away. The Bible tells that in the book of tells us that in the book of Matthew. There's going to be a great falling away. The writer of the book of Hebrews says, listen, in the last days, there's going to be a great falling away. Now, when you see the last days, the final days coming, don't forsake the assembling of yourselves together. You know, there are some statistics that I read recently. In fact, it was from an institute called the Pew Research Institute. And this Pew Research Institute, the headlines on this article were, "Pastors, you should be alarmed." Well, when I read that, it gets my attention. Pastors, you should be alarmed. So, okay, what should I be alarmed about? So I opened up the article, began to read the article, and the article was, "Pastors, you should be alarmed because 10 years ago, 78% of Americans claimed some sort of church affiliation, even if it was going to church one day a year. They claimed a church affiliation. 10 years later, that number has gone from 78% of people in America claiming a church affiliation to 70% claiming a church affiliation. So we should be alarmed. And yet, I don't know that I'm really alarmed because I don't see that trend in our church, thank God. But if it is, I need to just be honest with you. I do know that there are people who I've met who have dropped out of church, you know, and they just don't think, well, you know, church isn't really necessary, right? I mean, they say, I can worship God by myself. I can worship God out here by the lake. Because when I'm out here by the lake, I really feel Jesus. And I feel that fish, right? And so, I mean, there are all kind of reasons why people drop out of church or whatever. And one of the reasons, because church isn't perfect. Listen, you hang around church for any length of period, somebody is going to offend you. Somebody's going to make you mad. And that somebody may be me. I mean, you may love me one week, but you may hate me the next. Because I'm preaching something, and you think I'm preaching to you because you think I talk to your wife about what you're doing, and I haven't talked to anybody about anything, man. I'm just talking to Jesus, and he's telling me what to say, and God's trying to talk to you, but you get offended because you walk out thinking I talked to somebody. But listen, I learned a long time ago, man, I'm not here to try to make you happy. I'm here to try to make him happy. And as long as I make him happy, we'll be okay. And listen, if you go to church anywhere, man, there are no perfect churches. And if you find a perfect church, don't go. You'll mess it up, man. Right? Am I right about this? There are so many people that are hurt, hopping from this church to that church and from this church to that. And they never get their roots down any place. And listen, I'm here to say, see, God will sometimes, he will purposely cause me to offend you. Pastor didn't come and visit me. I love you. Pastor didn't shake my hand. I'm not going back to that church. Listen, God didn't want me to shake your hand. Some of you think I got an S on my chest and a yellow boots and a red cape that says Superman on the back. Listen, I'm not Superman. God didn't have any supermen. There's only one Superman. He died. He rose from the dead. He's sitting at the right hand of the Father. That's the only Superman in this house. And God will sometimes allow the preacher to offend you on purpose. I found that out. I've been doing this for 30 years, 30 some odd years. And I found out after 30 some odd years, God will allow the preacher to offend people sometimes on purpose. Why? Because the people are falling in love with the preacher. And some preachers fall in love with the people. And they become codependent. But if I read my Bible right, you are the bride, and he is the groom. I am just a groom's man. Hello, somebody. I performed a wedding yesterday, and the groom stood right next to me. And when that bride came out and started walking down, this boy started crying because his bride was walking down the aisle. Now listen, his bride was looking at him, and she was crying, and daddy was crying, and man, and the man was crying, and everybody was crying. Why? Because these two had eyes for one another. And can you imagine if she walked down that aisle and she was looking at one of the groomsmen? I'm marrying him, but I'm in love with you. Groomsmen would have been in trouble. Come on, somebody. I'm just a groomsman. Don't you wink at me. Don't you fall in love with me. You're walking down an aisle, and Jesus is your groom, and your eyes better be on him. Otherwise, you're in trouble. I'm in trouble. Everybody's in trouble because he is the groom, and you are the bride. Oh, hallelujah. My Lord, I'm about ready to take a lap around this place. Come on, somebody. You don't want to fall in love with a preacher. That's why God will sometimes make the preacher do something that you just shake your head. Why? Because God doesn't want you falling in love with a preacher. Preacher didn't die for you. Preacher wasn't buried for you. Preacher didn't go into hell for you. Preacher didn't rise from the dead for you. Preacher isn't coming back on a white horse. No, there's only one that's coming back on a white horse. His name is Jesus. He's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He is the Redeemer. He is the Savior. He is the Deliverer. Woo, hallelujah. You see, Your lame excuse of, I'm not going to church because this preacher. I'm not going to church because I like to worship God by myself. I don't go to church because of whatever reason that these people come up with. Listen, your example is Jesus. And if Jesus was found daily in the temple teaching, because he said to the Pharisees, what are you doing? I was daily in the temple teaching this very thing. Why do you come to me like this? See, Jesus was so interested in the church that the Bible says this. He was so interested in the gathering of the believers that the Bible says this. Where two or more are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst. If he was every day in the temple, if he is there in the midst as we come together, if the Bible says the zeal of thy house hath eaten me up. See, if this thing is so important to Jesus, then it ought to be important to us. If he was in the house, we ought to be in the house. If he was on fire about it, we need to be on fire about it, because our example is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And if it's important to him, it's important to us. I better watch out. I'm going to give myself a hernia or something. So let's move on. Let's put them first. Put them first in your week. Put them first in your finances. Put them first. Oh yeah, in your finances. In your day. Somebody say in your day. In your week. In your finances. In my day. In my week. In my finances. Here we go. You're really gonna like this one. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there might be food in my house, God said. Proverbs chapter 3 says, honor the Lord by giving him the first part. Somebody say first part. And then he will fill your barns with wheat and barley, and he will overflow your garage with new cars. Well, that's kind of what it's saying, but not really. That's wine vats with the finest of wines. Now, Pastor, the Bible says here, honor the Lord by giving him the first part of your income, by giving him the first fruit. Well, see, back in those days, why did they call it first fruit? Because back in those days, when you gathered your harvest, it was the first fruit, it was the first part that you brought to the Lord. whether it was the first part of the lambs, the firstborn of the lambs, whether it was the firstborn of the oxen, whether it was the firstborn of the children to be dedicated to the Lord. The first part of all the blessing was to be given to the Lord. Now, why was that? Well, the Bible tells us in Deuteronomy chapter 14, verse 23, that the purpose of tithing is to teach you to put God first. Somebody say first. We have that scripture? Deuteronomy chapter 14, verse 23. Doing this will teach you always to fear the Lord your God. That's the NIV, the Living Bible says, the purpose of tithing is to teach you to put God first. Some say put God first. Look at Proverbs chapter 3, verse 6. Do we have that scripture? Proverbs 3 and verse 6? Probably not. But it says this, if you put me first, some say put me first, I'll direct you and I'll crown your efforts with success. How many of you would like God to direct you? How many of you would like God to crown your efforts with success? See, the reason sometimes we don't have our efforts crowned with success is because we haven't put God first. What is God saying? Here's what God's saying. Let me just simply give it to you. God's saying, if you give me the first part, then your obedience to me releases my blessing upon the rest. So what's he saying? If you bring a tithe, what's a tithe? The tithe is a dime out of every dollar. If you bring a dime out of every dollar that comes your way, and you give it to me, God says, I will bless the 90 cents that you have left over. Now, there are some people who say, Pastor, why does God command me to bring a dime out of every dollar? I don't know. God could have chose 20 cents. God could have chose 5 cents. But God didn't. I don't make up the Bible. God wrote it. Don't look at me. Don't look at the church. Ask God. God, why is it 10%? I don't know. Probably because it's not so little that you don't feel it, and it's probably not so much that it kills you. That's the only thing I can think of. But the thing is, that's the number. And if that's the number, that's the number. Not 8%, not 9%, not 12%, 10%. And so God calls us to bring 10%. Now, when I bring 10%, here's the deal. When I bring 10% and I give it to God and I place him first, God says, I will bless the rest. Whew. Now, here's what I don't understand. If I keep 100%, I have 100%, but it's cursed. Because if it's not blessed, it's cursed. Oh, man, it's quiet in here. I love it. So if I bring 10%, it releases blessing upon the 90%. But if I keep 100%, it's all cursed. That's what the Bible teaches. So, what would you rather have? 100% of curse or 90% that's blessed? Give me the 90% that's blessed. Because I know that 90% with the blessing of God upon it will go further than 100% with a curse upon it. Are you with me? And so the Bible says that when we come, when we put God first in our day, when we put God first in our week, when we put God first in our finances, God says, put me first, and I'll bless everything you have. You want to be blessed? You want your family? You want your children? You want your business? You want everything to be blessed? Here's how to do it. Put me first. Put me first in your finances. Put me first in your week. Put me first in your day. Put me first in your relationships, and everything will be blessed. See, if you want God first in your life, according to the scripture, you really need to choose who you hang out with. But where do you see that, Pastor? Proverbs chapter 27, verse 19. I'm just trying to give you something that you can live by. And here's what it says. What a man is really like is shown by the kinds of friends he chooses. Let me say it again. Say it with me. What a man is really like is shown by the kinds of friends he chooses. Here's another scripture. Let's bring that other scripture from Proverbs up. It's Proverbs chapter 12, verse 26. Do we have that? Okay, good. A righteous man is careful. Somebody say careful. Do you want to be doer of the word? Did you come to church this morning just to like put some time in and go home and forget about, or did you come to really learn and really put it into practice? Okay, if you really came to learn and put it into practice, look at this. A righteous man, and if you want to be righteous, you need to be careful about your friendships. Let's go back to that first one that we were talking about just a moment ago. Proverbs 27, verse 19, what a man is really like is shown by the kinds of friends he chooses. Now, can I say to you this morning that if you're going to put God first in your life, you're going to have to choose your friends carefully. Why? Because you become like who you hang out with. You hang out with people who are casual Christians, you become a casual Christian. You hang out with people who say, I don't know if I go to church today. I think I'll stay home and grill out. You want to come on over? We'll watch the game. Casual Christian. Do you want to be a casual Christian or do you want to be an on-fire Christian? Do you want to be a pygmy for God or do you want to be a giant for God? What do you want? Who do you want to be like? Because whoever you hang out with is who you're going to become like. You know, there's some people say, you know what? Hey, man, I'm not a gangbanger. I don't do that. I'm not a thug. Listen, if you're hanging out with thugs, you may not be a thug now, but if you continue to hang out with thugs, pretty soon you're going to become a thug. Because the way they walk, the way they talk, what they do, they're all of it's going to rub off on you. Well, you know what, Pastor, man, I don't smoke dope. I don't, but you know, I got some friends who do, and I kind of hang out with them. Listen, you may not smoke dope now, and you may not be a dope smoker now, but you hang out with people who smoke dope, before you know it, you're going to be a dope smoker. I'm just telling, I don't like to get smashed, Pastor. I just like to hang out down at the bar, and I like to hang out with my friends, and I'm not into drinking. I'm not into getting smashed. I don't like, see, you may not be into getting smashed right now, but you hang out with people who are into getting smashed. Before you know it, you're going to be getting smashed because you're hanging out with people who like to get smashed. Am I preaching to somebody this morning? Is this truth? Because you become who you hang out with. The Bible says, as iron sharpens iron, so a man sharpens the countenance of his friends. And so my question is, who do you want to be and what do you want to be like? And if you want to be a man of God, start hanging out with men of God. If you want to be on fire for Christ, start hanging out with people. And my question is, if you're not part of a small group, why? Because that, and that's why we hammer small groups in this church. And we say, everybody needs to be part of a small group. Everybody needs to be part of a small group. Why? Because you get around people who are on fire for God in small groups. See, there are some of you that say, well, I just don't have anybody in my life that's on fire for God. I just don't have anybody. You know, man, Pastor, I don't know. Come hang out with us. Because we're smacking the devil in our small group. We're kicking the devil in the teeth in our small group. We're opening up the Bible in our small group. Can I tell you that some of the most powerful people that ever influenced my life were not my age? I grew up in places that we used to call prayer meetings. And Sister Amy Fulton be playing the guitar. Brother Don Addy was Jamie's parents' age. And he'd open up the Bible, and he'd talk to us about the end times. And I'd look at Don Addy, and I'd look at Amy Fulton. And I'd look at these people who were 20 years older than me, and I'd say, God, I just want to be like that someday. And I got around people who began to sharpen me and begin to pour the Word of God into me. And it wasn't people who were my peers. It was people who were stronger and deeper and bigger and had more knowledge. And as I got around those people, they began to rub off on me, and then I'd step around people who were my own age, and they'd look at me and they'd say, man, how do you know the Word of God like you know the Word of God? Because I've been hanging around some giants, some men and women of God. And if you would do the same thing, you'd get in that too. My Lord, get involved in a small group. Start. Say, what kind of people are you putting in front of your kids? Jamie's parents put us in front of some great people. And a lot of those people are gone now. And I've had the privilege of preaching some of those people's funerals. And I realized that I wouldn't be the man that I am if her parents wouldn't have put their children in front of some great people. My question is, who are you putting your children in front of? And who are you putting in front of your children? And if you want your children to serve God and to be men and women of God, take them to a small group. Oh, my children are only 14 and 15. They don't want to go hang out with us. Who cares what they want? They don't know what they want. And the problem is you're trying to be their friend, and so you're trying not to make them upset. You're not called to be their friend. You're called to be their parent. I don't know where that came from, but that's for somebody in this house. Because God's got a call on your children. God's got an anointing for your children. And you're not bringing them before great people. And you have an opportunity to get them around some on-fire Christians. And when we stand before God, we'll not stand and give an account only for what we've done. We'll give an account for what we haven't done and we had the opportunity to do. I don't know about you. I want to put God first. Because as I put him first in my day, in my week, in my finances, and in my relationships, I know he's going to bless everything that I have. And he's going to bless all my children. And I stand before you today, and I'm done. I stand before you today, and if I were to die today, I would die a happy man because my children are serving God. And all of my grandchildren are in church. And it doesn't matter what kind of house I live in, what kind of car I drive. All my children love God, and that's all that matters. Pastor John's not here today. Where's he at? He's preaching to about 200 native kids up in Montana. And I look at that. I look at that, and I think, God, that's what it's all about. I was at a wedding last night, and the guy who walked down the aisle bawling his eyeballs out was my friend. Stood at the altar with his daughter, crying. And I had the privilege of giving him a hanky and elbowing him a little bit and say, you big crybaby. He's my friend. I can do that. But he stood up last night and he said that as a dad, the greatest thing that he can ask for is his son in law, but his son now, to serve God and for he and his daughter to raise their children in the ways of God. And as a parent, we know that's all that matters. So So put God first in your relationships. And when it comes to the end, you look back over your life and you'll not regret it. Put him first in your finances. Put him first in your week. And put him first every day. And when you do, it'll all come together. It might not be easy. But day by day, step by step, week by week, relationship by relationship, one act of obedience after another will bring us to the place God wants us to be. Amen. Stand with me.